Letter 1 of 41 Letters on Religious Subjects, 41 Letters on Religious Subjects by John Newton, on Trust in the Providence of God and Benevolence to His Poor. My dear friend, the more I think of the point you proposed to me, the more I am confirmed to renew the advice I then gave. There is doubtless such a thing as Christian prudence, but, my friend, beware of counterfeits. Self-love and the evil heart of unbelief will endeavour to obtrude upon us a prudence so-called, which is as opposite to the former as darkness to light. I do not say that now you have a wife and the prospect of a family, you are strictly bound to communicate with the poor in the same proportion as formerly. I say you are not bound, for everything of this sort should proceed from a willing mind. But if you should tell me the Lord has given you such a zeal for his glory, such a concern for the honour of the gospel, such a love to his members, such a grateful sense of his mercies, especially by granting you in this late instance of your marriage the desire of your heart, and such an affiance in his providence and promises that you find yourself very unwilling to be 1/6 in the year less useful than you was before, I could not blame you or dissuade you from it. But I do not absolutely advise it, because I know not the state of your mind, or what measure of faith the Lord has given you. Only this I believe, that when the Lord gives such a confidence, he will not disappoint it. When I look among the professors, yea, among the ministers of the gospel, there are few things I see a more general want of than such a trust in God as to temporals, and such a sense of the honour of being permitted to relieve the necessities of his people as might dispose them to a more liberal distribution of what they have at present in their power, and to a reliance on him for a sufficient supply in future. Some exceptions there are. Some persons I have the happiness to know, whose chief pleasure it seems to be to devise liberal things. For the most part we take care, first, to be well supplied, if possible, with all necessaries, conveniences, and not a few of the elegancies of life, then to have a snug fund laid up against a rainy day, as the phrase is. If this is in an increasing way, so much the better, that when we look at children and near relatives, we may say to our hearts, now they are well provided for. And when we have gotten all this and more, we are perhaps content, for the love of Christ, to bestow a pittance of our superfluities, a 10th or 20th part of what we spend or hoard up for ourselves, upon the poor. But alas, what do we herein more than others? Multitude, who know nothing of the love of Christ, will do thus much, yea, perhaps greatly exceed us, from the mere feelings of humanity. But it may be asked, would you show no regard to the possibility of leaving your wife or children unprovided for? Quite the reverse. I would have you attend to it very much, and behold, the Scriptures show you the more excellent way. If you have a little money to spare, would you not lend it to me if I assured you it should be repaid when wanted? I can point out to you better interest and better security than I could possibly give you. Proverbs 19:17, he that hath pity upon the poor lendeth unto the Lord, and that which he hath given will he pay him again. What think you of this text? Is it the word of God or not? Is he worthy of belief or not? Is he able to make good his word or is he not? I dare stake all my interest in your friendship, which I should be very loath to forfeit, that if you act upon this maxim in a spirit of prayer and faith and with a single eye to his glory, you shall not be disappointed. Read over Matthew 6:26-34. Shall we confine that reasoning and those promises to the primitive times? Say not, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, this thing might be. He has more ways to bless and prosper those who trust in him than we are able to point out to him. But I tell you, my friend, he will sooner make windows in heaven, turn stones into bread, yea, stop the sun in his course, than he will suffer those who conscientiously serve him and depend upon him to be destitute. Some instances we have had of ministers who have seemed to transgress the bounds of strict prudence in their attention to the poor. But they have been men of faith, prayer, and zeal, if they did it not from a caprice of humour or a spirit of indolence, but from such motives as the Scripture suggests and recommends. I believe their families have seldom suffered for it. I wish you to consult upon this head what Mrs. Aline says, in the affecting account she has given of that honoured and faithful servant of God, her husband, Joseph Aline. Besides, you know not what you may actually save in the course of years by this method. The apostle, speaking of some abuses that obtained in the church of Corinth, says, "For this cause many are sick among you." If prudence should shut up the bowels of your compassion, which I trust it never will, The Lord might quarter an apothecary upon your family, which would perhaps cost you twice the money that would have sufficed to refresh his people and to commend your ministry and character. But if, after all, prudence will be heard, I counsel you to do these two things. First, be very certain that you allow yourself in nothing superfluous. You cannot, I trust, in conscience think of laying out one penny more than is barely decent, unless you have another penny to help the poor. Then, secondly, let your friends, who are in good circumstances, be plainly told that, though you love them, prudence and the necessary charge of a family will not permit you to entertain them. No, not for a night. What, say you, shut my door against my friends? Yes, by all means, rather than against Christ. If the Lord Jesus was again upon earth in a state of humiliation, and he and the best friend you have standing at your door and your provisions so straight that you could not receive both, which would you entertain? Now he says of the poor, inasmuch as ye did it to the least of these my brethren, ye did it unto me. Your friends have houses of their own and money to pay at an inn, if you do not take them in, but the poor need relief. One would almost think that passage, Luke 14, verses 12 to 14, was not considered as a part of God's word. At least I believe there is no one passage so generally neglected by his own people. I do not think it unlawful to entertain our friends, but if these words do not teach us that it is in some respects our duty to give a preference to the poor, I am at a loss to understand them. I was enabled to set out upon the plan I recommend to you at a time when my certain income was much too scanty for my own provision and before I had the expectation or promise of assistance from any person upon earth. Only I knew that the Lord could provide me with whatever he saw needful, and I trusted that, if he'd kept me dependent upon himself and desirous to live for his service only, he assuredly would do so. I have as yet seen no cause to repent it. I live upon his promise, for, as to any present ways or means, everything here below is so uncertain that I consider myself in the same situation with the birds of the air, who have neither storehouse nor barn. Today I have enough for myself and something to impart to them that need. As to futurity, the Lord must provide. For the most part, I can believe he will. I can tell you, however, that now and then my heart is pinched, unbelief creeps in, and self would much rather choose a strong box, or what the world calls a certainty, than a life of absolute dependence upon the providence of God. However, in my composed hours I am well satisfied. Hitherto he has graciously taken care of me, therefore may my heart trust in him and be not afraid. Consider, my friend, the Lord has done well for you likewise. He has settled you peaceably in a good and honourable interest. He has now answered your prayers in giving you a partner with whom you may take sweet counsel, one that will help and strengthen you in your best desires. Beware, therefore, of that reasoning which might lead you to distrust the Lord your God or to act as if you did. You complain that there is too much of an expensive taste among some persons in your congregation. If you set yourself to discountenance this, and should at the same time too closely shut up your hands, they will be ready to charge you with being governed by the same worldly spirit, though in another form. If you have been hitherto tender and bountiful to the poor, and should make too great and too sudden an alteration in this respect, if the blame should not fall upon you, it probably would upon your wife, who, I believe, would be far from deserving it. If the house which has been open to the poor in former times should be shut against them now you live in it, would it not lead the people's thoughts back? Would it not open the mouths of those who do not love your ministry to say that, notwithstanding all your zeal about doctrines, you know how to take care of your own interest, as well as those whom you have thought indifferent and lukewarm in the cause of the gospel? Would it not? But I forbear. I know you need not such arguments. Yet consider how many eyes are upon you, watching for your halting. Now, at your first setting out is the proper time seriously to seek the Lord's directions, that you may, from the beginning, adopt such a plan as may be most to your own comfort, the honour of your character as a minister, the glory of him who has called you, and the edification of your people. It is easier to begin well than to make alterations afterwards. I trust the Lord will guide and bless you in your deliberations, and for my own part, I am not in the least afraid that you will ever have cause to blame me for the advice I have given, if you should be disposed to follow it. I have given you my opinion freely, and perhaps with an appearance of more strictness than is necessary, but I would apply our Lord's words in another case to this. All men cannot receive this saying. He that is able to receive it, let him receive it. If the Lord has given you this confidence in his word, you are happy. It is better than the possession of thousands by the year. I am, etc. End of letter 1. Letter 2 of 41 Letters on Religious Subjects by John Newton. Extract of a letter to a student in divinity. Dear sir, the subject of your last is important. I can sympathize with your anxiety, having known much of it myself, and therefore willingly devote my first leisure to your service. But shall I indeed condole with you, or shall I rather congratulate you on the perplexity you complain of? I know it is not pleasing, but I hope it will be sanctified and profitable to you. Though I am no enemy to the acquisition of useful knowledge, I have seen many instances of young men who have been much hurt by what they expected to reap advantage from. They have gone to the academy, humble, peaceable, spiritual, and lively, but have come out self-wise, dogmatical, censorious, and full of prudence founded upon the false maxims of the world. I have been ready to address them with that line of Milton, "If thou art he, but ah, how fallen!" I do not mention this as the necessary fault of the institution, but as the frequent effect of notions too hastily picked up, when not sanctified by grace nor balanced by a proportionable depth of spiritual experience. I am therefore glad to hear that, notwithstanding the advantages you have had in the pursuit of your studies, you feel an inward conviction that you still need something which you cannot receive from men or books in order to complete your fitness for the ministry, that you may be a workman that needs not to be ashamed and enabled rightly to divide, to distinguish and distribute, the word of truth. It seems to me a point of more curiosity than use to inquire too nicely into the modus of the Holy Spirit's assistance in the composure and delivery of sermons. If we cannot exactly state the boundaries between what we may deem the result of our own thoughts and the needful influence of the Holy Spirit, it seems a safe way to give him the honour of the whole, and to attribute nothing to ourselves but our infirmities. If we have a capacity, means for improvement, diligence to make use of those means, and if that diligence is attended with any degree of success, may we not acknowledge that the former links of this chain are the effect of his goodness and favour, no less than the latter? To the question, how far is it lawful to expect this assistance, I answer, it is lawful very far even to lay the whole stress upon it, so as to be firmly persuaded that we can neither meditate or speak to purpose without it. That if we have not this assistance, whatever else we have, or may think we have, we shall but darken counsel by words without knowledge. For this I think I have warrant in John 15 verse 5. If any person supposes he has so far mastered a system of divinity, that though he can indeed do better with the Spirit's assistance, yet he can make a tolerable shift without it, I envy him not this attainment. But if the question intends how far a dependence upon the Holy Spirit may lawfully supersede the use of means, I answer not in the least. The blessing and the means are so closely united that they cannot be separated. The blessing may be surely expected if diligently sought in the use of proper means, and we have no just reason to expect it without them. But to clear up the whole, let it be considered what may deserve the name of diligence in this matter, and what are the proper means. By diligence I understand spiritual diligence, such an active, improving, industrious habit as is peculiar to a heart impressed with some real, abiding sense of the love of God, the worth of souls, the shortness of time, and the importance of eternity. Without this turn of mind, though a man should spend 16 hours every day in his study, he may be a mere trifler. The greatest part of his application will be spent on what is least necessary, and his knowledge will chiefly prove of that sort which puffeth up without communicating any real benefit. Genesis 41 verse 21, Psalm 127 verse 2. The chief means for attaining wisdom and suitable gifts for the ministry are the Holy Scriptures and prayer. The one is the fountain of living water, the other the bucket with which we are to draw. And I believe you will find by observation that the man who is most frequent and fervent in prayer and most devoted to the word of God will shine and flourish above his fellows. Next to these, and derived from them, is meditation. By this I do not mean a stated exercise upon some one particular subject, so much as a disposition of mind to observe carefully what passes within us and around us, what we see, hear, and feel, and to apply all for the illustration and confirmation of the written word to us. In the use of these means, and an humble dependence upon the Lord, in all the changing dispensations we pass through, our spiritual experience will enlarge, and this experience is the proper fund of our ministerial capacity, so far as it may be considered inherent in us. Proverbs 16 verse 23, Matthew 13 verse 52, 1 John 1 verse 3. These means are of universal importance. The wisest can do nothing without them. The weakest shall not use them in vain. There are likewise subordinate means which may be helpful and should in general be attended to. Yet they ought not, I apprehend, to be considered as a sine qua non in a minister's call and fitness. The first preachers had them not, and some in the present day are enabled to do well without them. Under this head I principally intend all that comes under the usual denomination of literature. A competent acquaintance with the learned languages, history, natural philosophy, etc., is very desirable. If these things are held in a proper subserviency, if they do not engross too much of our time, nor add fuel to the fire of that self-importance which is our great snare, they may contribute to increase and enlarge our ideas, and facilitate our expressing ourselves with propriety. But these attainments, like riches, are attended with their peculiar temptations, and unless they are under the regulation of a sound judgment and a spiritual frame of mind, will prove, like Saul's armour to David, rather cumbersome than useful in preaching. The sermons of preachers thus qualified are often more ingenious than edifying, and rather set off the man than commend the gospel of Christ. As you desire my advice with respect to your future studies, I shall comply without hesitation or ceremony. The original scriptures well deserve your pains and will richly repay them. There is doubtless a beauty, fullness, and spirit in the originals, which the best translations do not always express. When a word or phrase admits of various senses, the translators can only preserve one, and it is not to be supposed, unless they were perfectly under the influence of the same infallible spirit, that they should always prefer the best. Only be upon your guard, lest you should be tempted to think that because you are a master of the grammatical construction, and can tell the several acceptations of the words in the best authors, you are therefore, and thereby, master of the spiritual sense likewise. This you must derive from your experimental knowledge and the influence and teaching of the Spirit of God. Another thing which will much assist you in composing and speaking properly and acceptably is logic. This will teach you what properly belongs to your subject and what may be best suppressed, and likewise to explain, divide, enumerate, and range your ideas to advantage. A lax, immethodical, disproportionate manner is to be avoided, yet beware of the contrary extreme. An affected starchness and over-accuracy will fetter you, will make your discourses lean and dry, preclude an useful variety, and savour more of the school lamp than of that heavenly fire which alone can make our meditations efficacious and profitable, either to ourselves or our hearers. The proper medium can hardly be taught by rule. Experience, observation, and prayer are the best guides. As your inquiry seems chiefly to be how to fill up your outlines, I would advise you to study the living as well as the dead, or rather more. Converse much with experienced Christians and exercised souls. You will find advantage in this respect, not only from the wise, but from the weak of the flock. In the course of your acquaintance, you will meet with some in a backsliding state, some under temptations, some walking in darkness, others rejoicing in the light, etc. Observe how their spirits work, what they say and how they reason in their several cases, what methods and arguments you find most successful in comforting the feeble-minded, raising up those who are cast down, and the like, and what answers they return. Compare these with the Word of God and your own heart. What you observe of 10 persons in these different situations may be applied to 10,000. For though some circumstances vary, the heart of man, the aids of grace, and the artifices of Satan, in general, are universally the same. And whenever you are to preach, remember that some of all these sorts will probably be before you, and each should have something said to their own peculiar case. The tempted and distressed will be most probably relieved by opening the various states and exercises of the heart, and by showing from scriptural and other examples that no new thing has befallen them. The careless and backsliders, who have made a profession, should be reminded of that blessedness they once spoke of and warned of their danger. Those who are now upon the mount should be cautioned to expect a change and to guard against security and spiritual pride. To the dead in trespasses and sins, some such will always be present, it is needful to preach the spirituality and sanction of the law, that they may be stirred up to seek to Jesus. Of him all awakened souls love to hear much. Let him therefore be your capital subject. If you discuss some less essential topic or bend all your strength to clear up some dark text, though you should display much learning and ingenuity, you will probably fall short of your main design, which I dare say will be to promote the glory of God and the good of souls. You will likewise find advantage by attending as much as you can on those preachers whom God has blessed with much power, life, and success in their ministry. And in this you will do well not to confine yourself to any denomination or party, for the Spirit of the Lord is not confined. Different men have different gifts and talents. I would not wish you to be a slavish admirer of any man. Christ alone is our master and teacher. But study the excellencies of each, and if you observe a fault in any, for no human models are perfect, you will see what you are yourself to avoid. Your inquiries respecting my own experience on this subject must be answered very briefly. I have long since learnt that if I was ever to be a minister, faith and prayer must make me one. I desire to seek the Lord's direction both in the choice and management of subjects, but I do not expect it in a way of extraordinary impulse, but in endeavouring to avail myself, to the best of my judgment, of present circumstances. The converse I have with my people usually suggests what I am to preach to them. At first my chief solicitude used to be what I should find to say. I hope it is now, rather, that I may not speak in vain. For the Lord has sent me here not to acquire the character of a ready speaker, but to win souls to Christ and to edify his people. As to preparation, I make little use of books except the Bible and Concordance. Though I preach without notes, I most frequently write more or less upon the subject. Often, when I begin, I am at a loss how I shall proceed. But one thing insensibly offers after another, and in general I believe the best and most useful parts of my sermon occur de novo while I am preaching. This reminds me of Luther's maxim, bene precasse est bene studuisse. When I confined my heart in frame and liberty for prayer, everything else is comparatively easy. I should be very glad if anything I have offered may afford you satisfaction. The sum of my advice is this: examine your heart and views. Can you appeal to him who knows all things concerning the sincerity of your aim, that you devote yourself to the work of the ministry, not for worldly regards, but with an humble desire to promote the Redeemer's kingdom? If so, and his providence has thus far concurred with you, trust him for your sufficiency of every kind, and he will not disappoint you, but will be near to strengthen you according to your day. Depend not upon any cisterns you can hew out for yourself, but rejoice that you have liberty to come to the fountain that is always full and always flowing. You must not expect a mechanical sufficiency, such as artificers acquire by habit and exercise in their business. When you have preached well 19 times, this will be no security for the 20th. Yea, when you have been upheld for 20 years, should the Lord withhold his hand, you will be as much at a loss as at the first. If you lean upon books or men or upon your own faculties and attainments, you will be in fear and in danger of falling continually. But if you stay yourself upon the Lord, he will not only make good your expectations, but in time will give you a becoming confidence in his goodness and free you from your present anxiety. One thing more I must mention as belonging to the subject, that a comfortable freedom for public service depends much upon the spirituality of our walk before God and man. Wisdom will not dwell with a trifling, an assuming, a censorious, or a worldly spirit. But if it is our business and our pleasure to contemplate Jesus and to walk in his steps, he will bless us, we shall be like trees planted by a constant stream, and he will prosper the work of our hands. I am, etc. End of letter 2. Letter 3 of 41 Letters on Religious Subjects by John Newton. A letter to a friend on the question whether the sins of believers shall be publicly declared at the great day, or how are we to understand the apostle's assertion, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 10 compared with Romans 14 verse 12. My dear sir, my heart congratulates you. What changes and events many in younger life may be reserved to see, who can tell, but your pilgrimage is nearly finished. You stand upon the river's brink, with the city full in view, waiting and wishing for the appointed hour. You need not be anxious concerning your passage, for every circumstance attending it is already adjusted by infinite wisdom and love, and the King himself will be ready to receive you. While you continue here, I am glad to hear from you, and should be glad to contribute in any way or degree to your satisfaction, or even to show my willingness, if I can do no more. I can propose little more than the latter by offering my thoughts on the subject you propose from 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 10, and the apparent difficulty of understanding that passage, in full harmony with the many texts which seem expressly to assert that the sins of believers are so forgiven as to be remembered no more. There is doubtless, as you observe, a perfect consistence in every part of the Word of God. The difficulties we meet with are wholly owing to the narrowness of our faculties and the ignorance which in some degree is inseparable from our present state of imperfection. And we may, in general, rest satisfied with the thought that there is a bright moment approaching when the veil shall be wholly taken away. It is the part of faith to rest upon the plain declarations of Scripture, without indulging a blamable curiosity of knowing more than is clearly revealed. Yet while we humbly depend upon divine teaching, it is right to aim at as enlarged a sense of what is revealed as we can attain to. Every acquisition of this kind is more valuable than gold, especially respecting those points which have an immediate tendency to comfort and support us under the view of an approaching disillusion. The question you have proposed is undoubtedly of this nature. May the Lord direct my thoughts and pen, that I may not darken counsel by words without knowledge. I have been looking over the passage you refer to in Dr. Ridgely, and think I might be well excused from saying anything further on the subject, as he hath briefly and fully stated all the arguments that have occurred to me on either side of the question, and closes with a proper caution not to be peremptory in determining, lest by attempting to be wise above what is written, I should betray my own folly. Yet as you desire to have my thoughts, I must say something. I wish I may not give you reason to think that this caution has been lost upon me. I think all the great truths in which we are concerned are clearly and expressly laid down, not only in one, but in many places of Scripture, but it sometimes happens that here and there we meet with a text which, in the first and obvious sound of the words, seems to speak differently from what is asserted more largely elsewhere, which texts, singly taken, afford some men their only ground for the hypothesis they maintain. Thus the Arians lay a great stress on John 14, verse 28, and the Arminians on James 2, verse 24, etc., but their true interpretation is to be sought according to the analogy of faith. They are capable of a sense agreeable to the others, though the others are not intelligible in the sense they would fix upon these. In like manner, I would say, whatever may be the precise meaning of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, we are sure it cannot be designed to weaken what we are taught in almost every page of the free, absolute, and unalterable nature of a believer's justification, the benefit of which, as to the forgiveness of sin, is signified by the phrases of blotting out, not remembering, casting behind the back, and into the depths of the sea. The sins of a believer are so effectually removed that even when, or if, they are sought for, they cannot be found. For Jesus has borne them away. Believers are complete in him and clothed in his righteousness. They shall stand before God without spot or wrinkle. Who shall lay anything to their charge? But it is probable that those stray expressions chiefly, if not entirely, respect the guilt, imputation, and deserved consequences of sin. None can suppose that the Lord will or can forget the sins of his people, or that they can be ever hid from his all-comprehending view. Neither can I think they themselves will forget them. Their song is founded upon a recollection of their sins and their circumstances in this life, Revelation 5 verse 9, and their love, and consequently their happiness, seems inseparably connected with the consciousness of what they were and what they had done, Luke chapter 7 verse 47. And I think those are the sweetest moments in this life when we have the clearest sense of our own sins, provided the sense of our acceptance in the Beloved is proportionably clear, and we feel the consolations of his love, notwithstanding all our transgressions. When we arrive in glory, unbelief and fear will cease forever. Our nearness to God and communion with him will be unspeakably beyond what we can now conceive. Therefore, the remembrance of our sins will be no abatement of our bliss, but rather the contrary. When Pharaoh and his host were alive and pursuing them, the Israelites were terrified. But afterwards, when they saw their enemies dead upon the shore, their joy and triumph were not abated, but heightened by the consideration of their number. With respect to our sins being made known to others, I acknowledge with you that I could not now bear to have any of my fellow creatures made acquainted with what passes in my heart for a single day, but I apprehend it is a part and a proof of my present depravity that I feel myself disposed to pay so great a regard to the judgment of men, while I am so little affected with what I am in the sight of the pure and holy God. But I believe that hereafter, when self shall be entirely rooted out, and my will perfectly united to the divine will, I should feel no reluctance, supposing it for the manifestation of his glorious grace, that men and angels and devils should know the very worst of me. Whether it will be so or no, I dare not determine. Perhaps the difficulty chiefly lies in the necessity of our being at present taught heavenly things by earthly. In the descriptions we have of the great day, allusion is made to what is most solemn in human transactions, the ideas of the judgment seat, the great trumpet, of the books being opened, and the pleadings, Matthew 25, verses 37 to 44, seem to be borrowed from the customs that obtained amongst men to help our weak conceptions, rather than justly and fully to describe what will be the real process. Now, when we attempt to look into the unseen world, we carry our ideas of time and place and sensible objects along with us, and we cannot divest ourselves of them or provide ourselves with better. Yet perhaps they have as little relation to the objects we aim at as the ideas which a man born blind acquires from what he hears and feels have to the true nature of light and colours. Mr. Locke mentions one who, after much thought and conversation, supposed he had got a tolerable notion of scarlet, and that it was something nearly resembling the sound of a trumpet. Perhaps this is no improper emblem of the utmost we can attain to when we are endeavouring to realise the solemnities of the judgment day. What we mean by memory and reasoning may possibly have no place in the world of spirits. We guess at something more suitable, perhaps, when we use the term intuition. But I apprehend we must die before we can fully understand what it signifies. Perhaps thoughts may be as intelligible there as words are here. In a word, my dear sir, if I have not given you satisfaction, I am sure I have not satisfied myself, except my apology in the words of a much wiser and an inspired man. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. Ere long we shall know. In the meanwhile, our cause is in sure hands. We have a shepherd who will guide us below, an advocate who will receive and present us before the throne above. I trust we meet daily before the throne of grace. Hereafter we shall meet in glory. The paper will allow no more. Believe me, yours in the Lord, etc. End of letter 3. Letter 4 of 41 Letters on Religious Subjects by John Newton to Theron on Family Worship. Sir, a neglect of family prayer is, I am afraid, too common amongst professors in this day. I am glad that you consider it both as a duty and a privilege, and are by grace determined that when you shall commence master of a family, you will worship God with all your house. It was Abraham's commendation that he not only served the Lord himself, but was solicitous that his children and household might serve him likewise. I trust that he who inclines your heart to walk in the footsteps of faithful Abraham will bless you in the attempt and give you peace in your dwelling, a mercy which is seldom enjoyed, which indeed can hardly be expected, by those families which call not upon the Lord. Though I readily comply with your request and should be glad if I can offer anything that may assist or animate you in your good purpose, I am afraid I shall not answer your expectations with regard to the particulars of your inquiry concerning the most proper method of conducting family worship. The circumstances of families are so various that no determinate rules can be laid down, nor has the Word of God prescribed any, because, being of universal obligation, it is wisely and graciously accommodated to suit the different situations of his people. You must, therefore, as to circumstantials, judge for yourself. You will do well to pursue such a method as you shall find most convenient to yourself and family, without scrupulously binding yourself, when the Scripture has left you free. We have no positive precept enjoining us any set time for prayer, nor even how often we should pray, either in public or private, though the expressions of continuing instant in prayer, praying without ceasing and the like, plainly intimate that prayer should be frequent. Daniel prayed 3 times a day, which the psalmist speaks of as his practice likewise, and in one place declares his purpose of praising God 7 times a day. This last expression is perhaps indefinite, not precisely 7 times, but very often. Indeed, a person who lives in the exercise of faith and love, and who finds by experience that it is good for him to draw nigh to God, will not want to be told how often he must pray, any more than how often he must converse with an earthly friend. Those whom we love to be much with. Love is the best casuist, and either resolves or prevents 1,000 scruples and questions which may perplex those who only serve God from principles of constraint and fear. And a believer will account those his happiest days when he has most leisure and most liberty of spirit for the exercise of prayer. However, I think family prayer cannot be said to be stated unless it is performed at least daily, and, when unavoidable hindrances do not prevent, 2 times a day. though all times and seasons are alike to the Lord, and his ear is always open whenever we have a heart to call upon him, yet to us there is a peculiar suitableness in beginning and closing the day with prayer, in the morning to acknowledge his goodness in our preservation through the night, and entreat his presence and blessing on our persons and callings in the course of the day, and at night to praise him for the mercies of the day past, to humble ourselves before him for what has been amiss, to wait on him for a renewed manifestation of his pardoning love, and to commit ourselves and our concerns to his care and protection while we sleep. You will, of course, choose those hours when you are least liable to be incommoded by the calls of business, and when the family can assemble with the most convenience. Only I would observe that it greatly preserves regularity and good order in a house to keep constantly to the same hours when it is practicable, and likewise that it is best not to defer evening prayer till late, if it can be well avoided, lest some who join in the exercise, and perhaps the person himself who leads in it, should be too weary or sleepy to give a due attention. On this account I should advise to have family prayer before supper, where people have the choice and disposal of their own hours. I think, with you, that it is very expedient and proper that reading a portion of the Word of God should be ordinarily a part of our family worship, so likewise to sing a hymn or psalm, or part of one, at discretion, provided there are some persons in the family who have enough of a musical ear and voice to conduct the singing in a tolerable manner, otherwise perhaps it may be better omitted. If you read and sing, as well as pray, care should be taken that the combined services do not run into an inconvenient length. The chief thing to be attended to is that it may be a spiritual service, and the great evil to be dreaded and guarded against in the exercise of every duty that returns frequently upon us is formality. If a stated course of family prayer is kept up as constantly in its season as the striking of the clock, it may come in time to be almost as mechanically performed, unless we are continually looking to the Lord to keep our hearts alive. It most frequently happens that one or more members of a family are unconverted persons. When there are such present, a great regard should be had to them, and everything conducted with a view to their edification, that they may not be disgusted or wearied, or tempted to think that it is little more than the fashion or custom of the house, which will probably be the case unless the master of the family is lively and earnest in performance of the duty, and likewise circumspect and consistent in every part of his behaviour at other times. By leading in the worship of God before children, servants, or strangers, a man gives bond, as it were, for his behaviour, and adds strength to every other motive which should engage him to abstain from all appearance of evil. It should be a constant check upon our language and tempers in the presence of our families, to consider that we began the day and propose to end it with them in prayer. The Apostle Peter uses this argument to influence the conduct of husbands and wives towards each other, and it is equally applicable to all the members of a family, that your prayers be not hindered, that is, either prevented or put off, or despoiled of all life and efficacy by the ferment of sinful passions. On the other hand, the proper exercise of family prayer, when recommended by a suitable deportment, is a happy means of instructing children and servants in the great truths of religion, of softening their prejudices and inspiring them with a temper of respect and affection, which will dispose them to cheerful obedience and make them unwilling to grieve or offend. In this instance, as in every other, we may observe that the Lord's commands to his people are not arbitrary appointments, but that, so far as they are conscientiously complied with, they have an evident tendency and suitableness to promote our own advantage. He requires us to acknowledge him in our families, for our own sakes, not because he has need of our poor services, but because we have need of his blessing, and without the influence of his grace, which is promised to all who seek it, are sure to be unhappy in ourselves and in all our connections. When husband and wife are happily partakers of the same faith, it seems expedient, and for their mutual good, that besides their private devotions and joining in family prayer, they should pray together. They have many wants, mercies, and concerns in common with each other and distinct from the rest of the family. The manner in which they should improve a little time in this joint exercise cannot well be prescribed by a third person, yet I will venture to suggest one thing, and the rather as I do not remember to have met with it in print. I conceive that it may prove much to their comfort to pray alternately, not only the husband with and for the wife, but the wife with and for the husband. The Spirit of God, by the Apostle, has expressly restrained women from the exercise of spiritual gifts in public, but I apprehend the practice I am speaking of can no way interfere with that restriction. I suppose them in private together, and then I judge it to be equally right and proper for either of them to pray with the other. nor do I meet anything in St. Paul's writings to prevent my thinking that if he had been a married man, he would, though an apostle, have been glad of the prayers of his wife. If you ask how often they should pray together, I think the oftener the better, provided it does not break in upon their duties, once a day at least, and if there is a choice of hours, it might be as well at some distance from the other seasons of worship. But I would observe, as before, that in matters not expressly commanded, prudence and experience must direct. I have written upon a supposition that you use extemporary prayer, but as there are many heads of families who fear the Lord and have not yet attained liberty to pray extemporary before others, I would add that their inability in this request, whether real or whether only proceeding from fear and an undue regard to self, will not justify them in the omission of family prayer. Helps may be procured. Mr. Jenks's devotions are in many hands, and I doubt not, but there are other excellent books of the same kind with which I am not acquainted. If they begin with a form, not with a design to confine themselves always to one, but make it a part of their secret pleading at the throne of grace, that they may be favoured with the gift and spirit of prayer, and accustom themselves, while they use a form, to intersperse some petitions of their own, there is little doubt, but they will in time find a growth in liberty and ability, and at length lay their book entirely aside. For it being every believer's duty to worship God in his family, his promise may be depended upon to give them a sufficiency in all things for those services which he requires of them. Happy is that family where the worship of God is constantly and conscientiously maintained. Such houses are temples in which the Lord dwells, and castles garrisoned by a divine power. I do not say that by honouring God in your house you will wholly escape a share in the trials incident in the present uncertain state of things. A measure of such trials will be necessary for the exercise and manifestation of your graces, to give you a more convincing proof of the truth and sweetness of the promises made to a time of affliction, to mortify the body of sin, and to wean you more effectually from the world. But this I will confidently say, that the Lord will both honour and comfort those who thus honour him. Seasons will occur in which you shall know, and probably your neighbours shall be constrained to take notice, that he has not bid you seek him in vain. If you meet with troubles, they shall be accompanied by supports and followed by deliverance, and you shall, upon many occasions, experience that he is your protector, preserving you and yours from the evils by which you will see others suffering around you. I have rather exceeded the limits I proposed, and therefore shall only add a request that, in your addresses at the throne of grace, you will remember, etc. End of letter 4. Letter 5 of 41 Letters on Religious Subjects by John Newton, on the snares and difficulties attending the ministry of the gospel. Dear Sir, I am glad to hear that you are ordained, and that the Lord is about to fix you in a place where there is a prospect of your being greatly useful. He has given you the desire of your heart, and I hope he has given you likewise a heart to devote yourself, without reserve, to his service, and the service of souls for his sake. I willingly comply with your request, and shall, without ceremony, offer you such thoughts as occur to me upon this occasion. You have, doubtless, often anticipated in your mind the nature of the service to which you are now called, and made it the subject of much consideration and prayer. But a distant view of the ministry is generally very different from what it is found to be when we are actually engaged in it. The young soldier who has never seen an enemy may form some general notions of what is before him, but his ideas will be much more lively and diversified when he comes upon the field of battle. If the Lord was to show us the whole beforehand, who that has a due sense of his own insufficiency and weakness would venture to engage? But he first draws us by a constraining sense of his love, and by giving us an impression of the worth of souls, and leaves us to acquire a knowledge of what is difficult and disagreeable by a gradual experience. The ministry of the gospel, like the book which the apostle John ate, is a bitter sweet, but the sweetness is tasted first, the bitterness is usually known afterwards, when we are so far engaged that there is no going back. Yet I would not discourage you. It is a good and noble cause, and we serve a good and gracious Master, who, though he will make us feel our weakness and vileness, will not suffer us to sink under it. His grace is sufficient for us, and if he favours us with an humble and dependent spirit, a single eye and a simple heart, he will make every difficulty give way, and mountains shall sink into plains before his power. You have known something of Satan's devices while you were in private life, how he has envied your privileges, assaulted your peace, and laid snares for your feet, though the Lord would not suffer him to hurt you, he has permitted him to sift and tempt and shoot his fiery arrows at you. Without some of this discipline, you would have been very unfit for the part of your office which consists in speaking a word in season to weary and heavy-laden souls. But you may now expect to hear from him, and to be beset by his power and subtlety in a different manner. You are now to be placed in the forefront of the battle, and to stand, as it were, for his mark. So far as he can prevail against you now, not yourself only, but many others will be affected. Many eyes will be upon you, and if you take a wrong step, or are ensnared into a wrong spirit, you will open the mouths of the adversaries wider, and grieve the hearts of believers more sensibly than if the same things had happened to you while you were a layman. The work of the ministry is truly honourable, but, like the post of honour in a battle, it is attended with peculiar dangers. Therefore the apostle cautions Timothy, "Take heed to thyself and to thy doctrine." To thyself in the first place, and then to thy doctrine. The latter without the former would be impracticable and vain. You have need to be upon your guard in whatever way your first attempts to preach the gospel may seem to operate. If you should, as may probably be the case, where the truth has been little known, meet with much opposition, you will perhaps find it a heavier trial than you are aware of, but I speak of it only as it might draw forth your corruptions and give Satan advantage against you. And this may be two ways. First, by embittering your spirit against opposers, so as to speak in anger, to set them at defiance or retaliate upon them in their own way, which, besides bringing guilt upon your conscience, would, of course, increase your difficulties and impede your usefulness. A violent opposition against ministers and professors of the gospel is sometimes expressed by the devil's roaring, and some people think no good can be done without it. It is allowed that men who love darkness will show their dislike of the light.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.